Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Dr. Jody Guest. I'm an infectious disease epidemiologist and professor and vice chair in the Department of Epidemiology at Rollins School of Public Health at Emory University. Since March, I have been leading Emory's COVID-19 outbreak response team working in hard hit communities in Georgia. It is my pleasure to be the new host for Emory's COVID-19 Facebook Live events, where we will be speaking about our ever evolving knowledge of this pandemic. Today, I'm super pleased to be joined by Dr. Colleen Kraft. Welcome.
Thank you.
Dr. Kraft is an associate professor in the Department of Medicine in the Division of Infectious Diseases and an associate professor in the Department of Pathology, also at Emory School of Medicine. She is an associate chief medical officer at Emory Hospital and was one of the physician leaders bringing our Ebola virus patients from West Africa to Emory's hospital. So again, good afternoon, and thank you so much for joining me. I know we're a bit late starting due to some technical difficulties, so we're gonna jump right on in. We've got Halloween coming up soon. It is just in 3 weeks, but as we look backwards 4 weeks, we're seeing potentially an association in increased numbers of cases from Labor Day. Can you speak for a moment about that?
Yes, I think it's always sort of this month-long journey that we have from sort of a holiday that involves people congregating. And so I don't know if it's a spread within the population to those that are at most at risk, but we tend to see increased hospitalizations about a month after Labor Day or after a holiday. And we're certainly sort of anticipating that type of a surge now.
Great. So as we think about Halloween, just in 3 weeks, this is typically a holiday where we see kids out and about in the neighborhoods, we see parades, we see parties. Tell me what your thoughts are about this potentially being a problem as we're living through this unique set of times.
Yeah, so I think we're going to have to treat this pandemic Halloween like we have had to treat many other things along during this time, during this year of 2020. So I think that we have to be creative and innovative, and the basic principles, Jody, still apply, right? So wearing a mask, social distancing, hand sanitizing, and being creative with that regarding Halloween, which certainly is a holiday, being mostly outside and encouraging the use of masks. That should be something that we're able to do.
Great. So let's talk a little bit more about those masks, because this is that one holiday where we actually would see them anyway. Do we need to be concerned about wearing a face mask under Halloween masks?
I think this is a great question, Jody, and I was actually asked this yesterday as well. So remember that the mask that you wear is your source control. So we're not wearing masks around that are certainly that are cloth and otherwise that are really for our personal protection from other people. They're not filtering masks all the time unless you get those procedure masks from the pharmacy. Mm-hmm. Those are sort of more filtering masks. Otherwise, everything else that we're wearing in public is for us to keep our saliva and our sneezes and our coughs confined to a space that's around us and not into other people's personal space and into their mouth and nose as well, if you think about it. So it really, in my case, as long as the mask is going to prevent you from spraying a sneeze or a cough or exhaling air in the face of another person, it doesn't really matter what type of mask you wear.
Okay, great. So Halloween might be more suited to being protective than normal. Right. So CDC has actually classified trick-or-treating as a medium risk activity this year, and they're generally advising against it. What are your thoughts about trick-or-treating?
Well, I think having three sons who are pressuring us, of course, to go trick-or-treating, I think it's something that we, again, have to put parameters around. So I think obviously wearing a mask, hand sanitizing, you know, not probably dipping into the bag or into a bowl and then touching your face, right? So I haven't for a while talked about face hygiene because most of us have been wearing masks. But again, face hygiene is going to be really important if you have your mask off for some reason. And so I think that it's, it's something we have to be creative with. I think, you know, not holding parties with large groups of people always probably a good idea. I think, not having anything that's going to be close, like inside, should be completely avoided. But being outside, you wearing a mask if you're passing out candy, figuring out a way to pass it out and around from 6 feet away, I think is really important as well.
Okay, great. So as we think about passing out the candy, would you keep yours at the end of your driveway or at the end of your steps? And is that safer for you as the person passing it out?
Yeah. So I think, you know, even getting food service gloves or something like that. I think the biggest risk that's going to be on Halloween is in two places. One of them is the groups of kids that are going around together, right? So they're going to cluster together. They're not going to socially distance. So trying to encourage that as the adult that's walking around with them. And then also that interaction with the handing of candy. And so I think that's something that we can easily mitigate by having it be 6 feet away, and you may be monitoring it from 6 feet away. You know, there's been tons of creative things with people having tube delivery systems and, you know, those grabbers where they're handing it out from a distance. So I think there's a way to be fun and creative, memorable for this pandemic without introducing additional risk in the population.
And definitely think if we've seen anything, we've seen a lot of creativity these days. And so this is a good place to be doing that. What about those standard school Halloween parades? What are your thoughts on those?
Yeah, so I think standard and school, those words don't even go together anymore, right, this year. So I think, you know, my children actually are lucky to be in in-person school. And I don't think we're going to be, you know, to my knowledge, there'll be nothing that's indoors that will result in kids being close together. They're all separated regardless. And so I would say if those Halloween parades or those Halloween parties are different than what you're doing to control COVID risk, then you shouldn't do them.
Okay. That is
it's easy. A bummer.
It is. But a lot of things about 2020 have been a bummer and forced us to think differently. Okay. And how about neighborhood parties? Outside, we've typically had them in our cul-de-sac, and so they're always outside. What do you think about the neighborhoods getting together?
Yeah, so Jody, I think your neighborhood cul-de-sac is a good way to even celebrate Halloween without actually doing trick-or-treating potentially. So you may end up doing sort of a quarantine bubble party where the people that you've been sort of around the most and that observe COVID hygiene the same way you do, you are together, but doing something maybe different. You know, there's a lot of trunk or treat that's happening where there's sort of more outdoor socially distanced activities that are occurring. I think outside parties that can be by naturally sort of distance, I think are fine to do. And again, you know, I've thought about maybe we do something like that instead of sending out the kids trick or treating. So they're just, again, I think creativity is really makes it fun, makes it enjoyable and can keep it safe as well, which is the most important thing.
Absolutely. So if people were to go neighborhood to neighborhood, again, we're not necessarily advising that. Would you advise them to stay away from going out to people's doors?
I think so. I think that if the person who's handing out candy is not wearing a mask, I probably wouldn't go to that house. If you can tell that from a distance or even, I mean, as you get there, I probably wouldn't advise being in any sort of proximity to somebody not wearing a mask. I think that, you know, trying to figure out places that you know sort of will have the same type of safety as you're used to during this pandemic would be important if that's an area. I think people that tend to go to tons and tons of neighborhoods maybe want to scale that back. I know individuals that have 1,000 kids that come to their doorstep. I think there's certainly a candy tube in your future if you're going to be giving it to that many kids. I mean, I can't imagine having close proximity with 1,500 individuals at this time. You know, we're not only sort of in COVID pandemic, we're also entering respiratory season. We've had an uptick in people presenting with respiratory symptoms because of the ragweed and the pollen changing, as well as it getting colder, people's furnaces being on. And so I think we really want to maintain social distance as much as we can because there's more than just COVID out there.
Right. And then I know at the beginning of the pandemic, we had some concerns about takeout food boxes and things like this being ways to spread COVID-19. I think we've mostly gotten past that as a great fomite and way to spread it. What do you think about bags of candy being left out for people or even needing to wash the candy after the kids get home? Necessary or not?
Yeah, so I think that, you know, the days of washing our groceries are probably subsiding. Plus, we're trying to conserve those Lysol wipes for other parts of our house, right, as the shortages continue. I think, you know, if you're really concerned about the candy, then I think setting it aside for a day or two will allow the virus to die if it's on the outside. I think exactly what you said, you know, we're bringing in takeout food and groceries into our house every day and probably not washing them. I'm not sure that the candy is going to be a lot different. Although if you're passing out candy, I really think you should be doing hand sanitizer and being as clean as possible.
Great. So we want to be good examples if we were to choose to do it. individually. Okay, great. Is there anything else that you think that in our last few minutes today that we should be thinking about as we look at Halloween coming up and what might happen with the numbers after Halloween if we don't do this well?
Right. So let us work to not make Halloween a super spreader event. I think that's a good summary statement. Using the basic principles that we know will keep us safe. So we will have we can have a fun time. We can have all these things that we're used to having, but let's just keep those basic principles in mind, which are hand hygiene, face hygiene, wearing a mask, and socially distancing. Be creative. And it'll be a memorable pandemic Halloween.
Absolutely. Do you think there's any chance we'll see more epidemiologists or infectious disease physicians running around in our costumes this year?
I don't know, but one could only hope. It's a great career to pursue.
It's a great career, and PPE would be a great thing to be wearing for Halloween this year, for sure.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Kraft. We really enjoyed talking to you today, and everyone out there, please stay really safe and recognize that a lot of the spread of this disease is in your control. So please stay outside, please stay safe, please wear your masks. Thank you so much.